Thank you very much. Can you hear me way back there? Am I good back there? Okay, well, thank you, David. It's a wonderful day for me to be here in so many ways, including with Larry and Bob receiving these awards, which I heard about last night, and of course, had to keep from saying to them, so it's just very exciting and adds all more to my pleasure and honor in being here. Unlike Larry, I don't memorize things. I have little notes, so I don't ramble off onto too many stories and hopefully keep focused. It's a wonderful year for me to be here with my research interest at this occasion because it's basically the 50th year of power structure research. That's because Mills' famous book, The Power League, was published in 1956 to a huge hue and cry that we'll talk about in a moment. No one was happy with it. Everybody was upset. Not liberals, not Marxists, not most sociologists. But it was a gateway to research in the 60s and the 70s and a whole new field of power structure research, which is part of a panel later this afternoon with Roy Barnes and Emily Sweezy and Jim Vaughn that you can catch, among others. But it wasn't just Mills. I also want to mention to you that there was another amazing sociologist who started power structure research, now also almost disappeared, named Floyd Hunter. He had a study that came out in 1953 called Community Power Structure. It was actually about Atlanta, Georgia. He was a ninth-generation Kentuckian, University of Chicago MA in social work in the mid-30s. He now worked on all kinds of settings just below the power elite, including setting up canteens for soldiers during World War II. And then he went to work in Atlanta. He was a strong integrationist, but they put him to work in housing and youth thing. But he, as I said, he was a strong integrationist. He was soon fired. He went to Chapel Hill and got a PhD in sociology, using a new method called the reputational method to figure out who were the powerful. He called it the take me to your leader method. It was a form of network discovery, a sociometric kind of method. And this method was widely used by sociologists, now forgotten in many ways, but widely used in the 50s and 60s at the local level. And Hunter himself even used it a couple of times at the national level, had very similar findings to Mills. So these two people that I'm going to describe as iconoclasts started this field of power structure research, which is an attempt to construct a network of people and institutions that first of all run the show. But it's not just about the top. It goes from the top to the bottom. A power structure is a pecking order. And there's not just an elite with a blob on the bottom. It's all structured. There are bases of power at other levels. There are activists who can change things. In short, in this theory, in the theory that they had, agency does matter. I want to suggest that power structure research is unique in many ways in sociology. And as I run through this, I think I'm taking many people down memory lane. But to all of you that are students, I'm really inviting you into an area of research to help rejuvenate it. To overcome the mainstream that still, in general ways, mostly reigns within sociology, despite the efforts of Larry Reynolds. I want to suggest to you power structure research is interesting for a number of reasons. First of all, it did appear all of a sudden in those mid-50s. There were no previous studies like those by Mills and Hunter. Nobody had ever studied a complete power structure of a city or of the United States. It was not part of the establishment. It was from the margins. They were outsiders. But they were outsiders who were well-trained sociologists. It was not muckraking. It was not investigative journalism, as the mainstream claimed. It was radical. It was upsetting. But they drew on accepted theories and methods. Hunter talked the language of structure and function and institutions. Mills talked about big bureaucracy. The reputational method, as I already said, was a sociometric kind of method, or in Mills' case, he was studying career paths and class backgrounds, which was not out of the blue in terms of methodology, but they put it together in a different kind of way. And intellectually, they were left Weberians. They thought that organization was the basis of power, even eventually of class power in large-scale societies. But they were neither benign organizational theorists trying to help organizations run more smoothly, which I think is what most organizational theorists have done in all the social sciences since they were financed by big foundations in the 20s and 30s. Nor were they elitists who said that power structures were inevitable. They believed in the promise of greater participation and democracy. Power structure research had further uniquenesses. It was done by students. It was done by activists in the 60s and the 70s. Some of the finest power structure research, which is footnoted in the various books that I and others have written, was done by students who were activists. Who rules Columbia? Go to school, learn to rule, which was about Yale. How Harvard rules. There was a pamphlet in the 60s called The Care and Feeding of Power Structures by a man named Jack Minnis, who was part of SNCC, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee in the Southern Civil Rights Movement. Find the northern connections of these southern segregationist organizations and picket those big New York banks using power structure research. And there were many such studies, as I said, and they're not lost to history. They were inspirational. They were certainly part of why I got into power structure research 43 years ago. It now is. There's one final weakness, uniqueness, and that's a weakness and a uniqueness. Maybe it's a strength, actually, and that is it's not funded by foundations. And I think if you did a network analysis through looking at prefaces to books, thank so-and-so for this and that, look at who's funded by Ford and Rockefeller and Carnegie and this and that, as with various kinds of books, I think you can get a network of what's mainstream and what's marginal, what's radical, and what's not in sociology and the other social sciences. So I'm trying to convey to you these well-trained, but definitely in some sense radical, iconoclastic, marginal sociologists who kept crashing in on the discipline. Now in saying all that, I'm not saying necessarily they were right. In fact, I'm going to make some criticisms of some of their ideas today based on new research and more recent experience. And as we know, of course, hindsight is easy. But the first key point I want to make to you beyond a sense of the flavor is that what these two iconoclasts did was to open up space for a new approach by being neither liberal pluralist nor by being Marxist. They broke in on that dialogue, that lockstep, which still goes on to this day and still is the dominant discourse in one way or another in sociology and most of the other social sciences. I also want to say to you in passing another important thing that's not sociological, it's more historical and political. That is that Mills opened another space in the 50s, one that was very important politically, but didn't last as long. And that was Mills was the intellectual opening for the white New Left, who were inspired by the Civil Rights Movement and by Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee and started Students for a Democratic Society. Mills had been a leftist of the Socialist Party, anti-communist, anti-Moscow persuasion, which most American intellectuals were, but there was plenty of fights between them and the pro-communist kind of people. But in the light of some intellectual openings in Eastern Europe and Moscow in the late 50s, where there were some critics of standard communism, Mills said, let's talk to those people, let's go visit them, let's interact with them. And when the Cuban Revolution occurred, he said, let's go see if Castro means what he says. Let's drop what he called the old futilitarianism, which was what he meant about both sides of the old left. Let's not be sophisticated Marxists that re-explain everything, and let's not be communist Marxists, which he called crude Marxists. Let's be in the spirit of Marx and his general method, and let's go on and do it ourselves. And he was an enormous impact on many young sociologists of that day. People like Dick Flax, Bob Ross, now senior sociologist, all formative in SDS. Todd Gitlin marching around in front of the banks in New York because of network analysis that these southern companies were tied to these New York banks. Tom Hayden, the major left leader, who now has a book that's really fine that's out there called Radical Nomad, which is his 1964 MA thesis in political science at the University of Michigan, where he does this brilliant critique of Mills that none of us knew existed, with commentary at the beginning by Stanley Aronowitz and Charles Lemmert and Dick Flax. And I think it's a great entry point into the flavor of those times, a sense of Mills, a sense of where we got it right, a sense of where we got it wrong. Now, as I say, though, the opening that that he created politically, Mills created politically, didn't last very long. By the late 60s, the scene had changed, the theorists were very different. I will touch on that in a minute. But that's not my topic today. My topic today is the 50 years of findings and methods and what was accomplished. Because I do think that power structure research has explained the United States better than any of its rivals. And I want to go from there. Well, what did the Mills and Hunter say? Most of you know, but just to be sure, they said in a very general way, hey, corporations dominate. Let's face it, business dominates in these cities and dominates in the country at large. Politicians, political parties, they're all secondary. But they also said, hey, we think this can be changed. More democracy is possible. More participation is possible. I've already said to you, Hunter was an integrationist. He has a chapter in the community power structure on the black power structure of Atlanta and how it related to the white power structure and how the black leaders were able to maneuver within the narrow confines in which they were contained in terms of power relationship. And indeed, he was fired from his job because a man named Henry Wallace wanted to speak, become president of the United States in 1948 in Atlanta, and nobody would give him a place to speak. He was an integrationist as well as saying, let's try to cut a deal with the Soviets. And Floyd said, you could speak in the juvenile center that I run. And they said, Floyd, I think it's time to retire. It took a 1 year, you know, we'll give 1 year pay. And Floyd said, I don't think I'm running anymore. I did get to know him later. He said, I think you're going to have to fire me. And they did. So he was strong for that there were possible change. He was pleased with what all had happened in the 1960s. But as I said, they were met mostly with hostility and doubt in the social science fraternity. Many sociologists, I've already said, went out and used this reputational method in many different cities. They had very similar findings to Hunter, but the most sociologists, all political science, said the method was no good, and they went on to do their own kinds of studies, which basically in a strong methodological argument back and forth that I won't get into, they won. The pluralists won. And community power studies basically disappeared by the 1970s. Except what I want to tell you, and this is, I'm obviously giving a triumphalist kind of talk today, except that Hunter won. Hunter was vindicated by some things that happened in the 1970s. In particular, to start, a political scientist who had read his book, who was from South Carolina, good old boy, great guy, he went back and studied Atlanta using all the proper political science methods, and he says, you know, what's going on in Atlanta is the downtown elites are trying to expand, and they're expanding into the neighborhoods, and they're often low-income, and especially African-American neighborhoods. And that's the real tension of Atlanta. Floyd Hunter had it right. But most importantly, then along came a sociologist named Harvey Mollich, who graduated from the University of Michigan, and later with other sociologist John Logan wrote a book, Urban Fortune. But in the middle 1970s, Mollich wrote a paper called The City is a Growth Machine. And what he did was to theorize all of the literature really that had happened in power structure research and really then put a power behind it. Because it's not just business people that run a city, it's a different set of business people. They are growth elites, they are landed elites, they are developers, they are real estate people, they have a desire to intensify the use of land. That's their goal. And that's a different goal than a capitalist that sells commodities or products on the market. And these downtown elites, what they try to do is prepare the land for capital to attract investments. Creates a complex relationship between capitalists and these place entrepreneurs. It creates different kinds of tensions. Cities compete for developments. And so on. Furthermore, there is a tension in the city that I've already mentioned from this work on Atlanta, and that is that these city elites want, by intensifying land use, they're constantly moving in on neighborhoods, and we know neighborhoods have deep sentiments. They know they have a use value for people. We care about our neighborhoods, a sense of safety, connections, jobs, and so on. And that's the dynamic of the city. And so with that kind of a theory, we've been able, I think, to really understand and grasp this literature that Floyd Hunter really created. Here I'll add a personal note. I got to know Floyd a little in the early 70s, and I asked him what he was up to. He's kind of semi-retired. He said, I think I'm going to do a book and compare New Haven, that's where this famous pluralist had studied, who governs, who it's called, I'm going to compare New Haven and Atlanta. Well, he didn't quite do that, but he gave me all his stuff and he goosed me into it. I went to New Haven. It was so gratifying because there was this growth machine, and unlike what the Yale professor said, Yale runs New Haven like autos ran Michigan, like insurance ran Hartford. And I was able to find all the documents, interview all the people, and so on. And the book was mentioned, David mentioned the book, but it's now on my website, whorulesamerica.net, called Who Really Ruled in Dolls, New Haven. And it's a very gratifying closure, and I think it's a tribute to Floyd Hunter, but also to the ideas of sociologists around the idea of a growth, a machine. Well, I've spent a little time there on the local level, but it wasn't the main show, and it certainly hasn't been the main show for a long time because we're interested in the national power structure. But I wanted you to have a sense of the vibrancy that once was around Floyd Hunter's work, and how, in fact, I think we have a really powerful theory about city politics, city dynamic, that incorporates all our past, more empirical studies when we didn't have the right, I don't think, the right theoretical framework, that certainly included me at the time, until Mollich came along and swept all of this work together. And I think it can be built on in excellent kind of ways. But what about Mills and the national level? The critics want to get, once again, pan the methods. He didn't study decisions, just social backgrounds, that was not enough. They didn't like the theory, his three-part power elite theory, where it basically said the leaders of the power elite are those who run the major hierarchies, which are the corporate hierarchies, then the federal government hierarchy that developed in the New Deal, and then the military hierarchy that developed during World War II. And he said they interact enough and coordinate enough, they are a power elite. And everything else is secondary, all the voluntary associations, the political parties, and so on, which was what then caused the anointing. Now, they certainly also didn't like the terminology. He called the military the warlords. He talked about the high and the mighty, a phrase that I really like, organized irresponsibility. That's how you pass the buck all through corporate directors, and we're seeing it today. We didn't do it. No, we didn't appoint a commission, cool it out, you know, all that organized kind of your responsibility. But beyond all that, there was a substantive argument. And that was, they said, look, you didn't show there's any cohesion among these people, that they have that social cohesion, that they can get it together to do anything in the way of exercise power. That is, you didn't show how they govern. You didn't show that process. And furthermore, you really, basically, they said, you can't explain the New Deal. You can't explain the Social Security Act. You can't explain the Wagner Act. How did all those liberal things happen? If there's this power elite. So that's what those of us that started out in the 60s then saw as our challenge and got into and researched. And basically we showed that there was plenty of social cohesion with these clubs and these schools and these retreats. Again, mentioned the Bohemian Grove and other retreats in which will be talked about later today again by Jim Vaughn. How these organizations do bond these people, it do create this kind of morale among this consciousness that I think is really very Durkheimian, if I may say so. So basically, we showed that this economic class called owners, big property owners or capitalists, was a status group in Weber's term, but we also showed they had this conscious collective, immanent morale in Durkheimian kind of terms. And I won't spend much time on that, but the point is, we were out there looking at clubs and prep schools and all of those kinds of social kinds of settings, which some later research said, oh, that's all fluff. It's just the way capital unfolds. But reacting to Mills's critic, we spent a lot of time on the upper class as a social class. And then we got into showing how they did dominate government. We showed there was a party in Weberian terms, except it was basically, you know, just focus on three main networks, not just political parties. And the first one is very obvious to all of us. We call it lobbying, but we call it, more theoretically, I think it's important to call it a special interest kind of process where individual families and corporations and industries, subsets of the economy, work every day in Washington to wire bureaucracies, to jimmy with Congress people, to get tax breaks, to get regulatory breaks. And every day you pick up the paper, you can pick an example of some amazing event that has made it so coal miners aren't protected, or so-and-so gets a huge tax break, and so on and so forth. To which Mills's critics reacted by saying, oh, sure, we know all that stuff, but that doesn't understand or explain to us the big policy. That's where you guys can't understand what happens, the big picture in America. And for that, we developed a policy planning network. And very simply, the corporations, the rich families that own corporations, created a set of foundations, which then created a set of think tanks and discussion groups, and we can watch policy move through that system, step by step by step, and we can do what we call a content analysis of the proposals and plans, and we can watch them move into government through blue ribbon commissions and testimony, and indeed, as Mills thought, the appointment of these people directly in the government. So when a big business person is appointed to government, they're not just from a big bank or a big corporation. They're also a director of a foundation. They've also discussed these matters at one of these policy discussion kinds of groups. And I would assert to you, in the brief, and I can't be in detail in brief time, try your patience, or maybe you risk missing the opening pitch of the game today between the Tigers and the Yankees, you can say that every policy we have studied rolls through this model in a beautiful kind of fashion, except for two, which I'm going to mention in a minute. Now, in that context, we can look at the political parties. And Mills and Hunter did make the mistake, I think, of neglecting the political process, of not showing how it worked, of making it too secondary. Mills downplayed the role of Congress too much. The power structure really is rooted in the Congress in a very important kind of way. And that is in turn related to the party system. And here I'm going to try to be substantive in a very quick kind of a way. But I think the key to understanding much about the American power structure is in understanding why we have a two-party system. And I think there's a two-part answer to that that I've said in many different places, so I'm repeating to some of you. But the point is these two factors, which are orthogonal almost, are so powerful together. And one is, for just simple historical reasons, where we elect people from a district, you know, your congressional district, your state of Michigan, we elect the President of the United States from this whole district called the United States, and we elect them through this plurality kind of system. It creates a set of rules, it's a structure that creates a powerful tendency towards a two-party system, which I think we ignore in our peril if we're interested in power and social change, and most radicals don't like what I'm about to say, because it's capital that matters, not the structure of the political system. And so they don't believe it when I say, believe me or anybody else, when they say this tremendous tendency towards a two-party system makes it so a vote for a third party of the left or of the right is really a vote for your worst enemy. And we saw that most radically, I'm sorry to say, and I'm anticipating the failures of the American left and of activists. When you go out there in the Nader Green Party in 2000, you had one left, one piece of power left, you had your vote. And if you were in New Hampshire or Florida, you cast that vote for Ralph Nader, and there, boy, by cast that vote for George Bush. And so that's the power analysis of how that two-party system works. But that's just the electoral rules. Why don't liberal and labor have their own party? And you must understand the history of the United States. Political economy is divided into North and South, free and slave, plantation capitalists, and then industrial kinds of capitalists. So I won't go into that in any detail, but the point is that what we've had, at least since 1877, well into the 70s and 80s, indeed to 94, we had a situation where the Democrats, which you see as the liberal party, it's the party of the southern rich, it's the party of the plantation capitalists, who went north to find allies always. And the Republicans were the party of the northern rich. So when a liberal labor coalition arose, and a lot of that story is the story of Michigan in the 30s and beyond, they had no place to go but the Democratic Party, which to the great annoyance of leftists, but they went into the Democratic Party and they were able to have some impact. But the terms of the deal were very sordid. And the terms of the deal were two. One was that the southern rich whites can super exploit their whole southern labor force, especially, of course, African Americans. That's 25-35% of the country, 25-30% of the country, where you essentially have no democracy, where you have the super exploitation of all labor, but as I say, especially of black labor. But there's a second part to this, and that is the Democrats, the Liberal Labor Coalition, will do little or nothing for African Americans in the North. Because they fear, rightly, that white racism would raise its head because there would be competition for good jobs. And that's a large percentage of the urban America that we're now talking about that's being ignored by the Democratic Party. And they're not trying, and here are these, I remember I interviewed a liberal in California once. He said, you must understand that my colleagues in these large urban areas, these white liberals, he said, they're already elected. They already win those states. They do not want African Americans voting. They are not going to help. They're with the Southern whites on this. And of course, in terms of their power, they were right. They're all replaced 40 years later. I mean, the urban areas have black representatives. They were swept aside. So they weren't out helping to change these things. But as I said, and I'm going to come back to that, liberals and labor then did have some power within the Democratic Party. And as they grew within the Democratic Party and their power, the Southern Democrats would vote with the North Republicans on various issues. All now history, ancient history to some of you, maybe not even known history to some of you, was called the Conservative Coalition or the Conservative Voting Bloc. And that's when a majority of Southern Democrats voted with a majority of Northern Republicans. What did they vote together on? Class issues. That's really summarizing, so I stay within a certain kind of time frame. What that I'm saying to you, class and power-wise now, is that when the Southern Democrats and the Northern Democrats were united, liberal and labor could not win. The Conservative Coalition meant a united ruling class at the congressional level. Well, that's the context within which we can explain the Social Security Act and something called the National Labor Relations Act, and then we can understand also the right turn that came in the 60s and the 70s. Basically, I can tell you through detailed research that I published in the middle 90s and then summarized in the latest edition of Who Rules America, that the policy planning network that I briefly, breathlessly fast outlined here a moment ago created all the details of the Social Security Act. It was created in foundations and think tanks started by Rockefeller-related money, the biggest companies of that era, created all the details of the Social Security Act. It was their experts that went into government, and it was then, of course, Roosevelt and the New Deal that legitimated it, so it's known as a New Deal policy, but it was actually created by modern Republicans. Well, how did this thing pass? How did they get the Social Security Act to pass? It was simple. They had to get the Democrats on their side. But how do you get the Democrats on your side? I've said it, the Democrats are the party of the Southern rich. And they did control that party totally, believe me, in the 1930s and pretty much well beyond. It was very simple. You just exclude agricultural, seasonal, and domestic labor from coverage in the Social Security Act. And that basically meant no blacks in the South would get Social Security, but it meant excluded a lot of whites too. In other words, you were not messing with the class relations in the South, and therefore you can have Social Security in the North. Basically, I'll summarize by saying the modern capitalists proposed, the ultra-conservatives, the Hooverites, now the Bushites, opposed, because of course Bush wants to get rid of Social Security, make it private. But the Southern Democrats disposed, they decided. Now we come to the key point, the Archimedean point of the New Deal and the Liberal Labor Coalition. In the context of the failure of something called the National Recovery Act, there was militancy in the northern working class, including right here in Michigan and in not far away in Flint and many other places. And in that context, the moderate Republicans, the same people that proposed Social Security, suggested they have a labor board where labor and corporate moderates would discuss together. So they created a plan. But you know what? In this case, it got away from them. The corporate moderates lost out. Labor and liberals got so strong, so militant, that they disrupted the system. Now, there's a lot of complex reasons for that, but one of the reasons was that no longer could you cut a deal with the white craft unions as you could in the past, because now industrial labor, including again Michigan, trying to bring it home here, were not prepared to, craft union could not keep the industrial union guys out. And when you have a united working class, you have more possibility. Well, you're headed for a clash with the people that started this
labor board, now opposing him. But the liberals were able to get a labor board, which became very important. How did they get that labor board? From a power point of view, you just exclude the southern workforce. The northern liberals went to the southern, said, we need this board. We've got to deal with a lot of class struggle in the north. And the southerners said, fine, just exclude agricultural, seasonal, and domestic labor. No problem. In other words, the southerners deserted the northerners at that key moment, making it possible to pass the National Labor Relations Act, and then Roosevelt won the 36th election, and there was this explosion of organizing that created the CIO, the UAW, the United Steel, all of those things that then were the power of the liberal labor kind of coalition. Power of this analysis is found in what happened. In 37 and 38, the Southerners that fast turned against the deal. Why? Because they saw how powerful liberal labor was getting, and second, the CIO went into the South and started to do integrated organizing. And that was anathema to the Southerners. They went back and cut a deal with the Northern Republicans, and indeed with the AFL, the craft union. In 39, they had a deal that became the Taft-Hartley Act in 1948, which severely weakened the National Labor Relations Act and began the slide for organized labor. But when Mills was writing in the 50s, now we're back to Mills, he said, you know what, big labor has cut a deal with sophisticated conservatives, which is what he called the moderates, and there's the stability. Unions are now at this secondary level. They're pretty powerful, but they're not part of power elite, but it's stable. And here Mills's mistake was he underestimated the class struggle. He underestimated class in America, the possibilities for corporate people to roll back what the unions had. The arrangements that I just explained to you were dynamited, they were blown to bits by the civil rights movement. Once again, we've got to understand activists. The right turn was not from the top. These analyses that talk about think tanks and right-wing foundations and new Christians and all that, I think are superficial. They're the icing on the cake. They don't get the underlying power dynamic. The turn was a right turn because of a white middle American turn to the Republicans in both the North and the South. What happened was the civil rights movement, which none of them wanted, no liberals, no moderates, no conservatives that today say, oh, of course we're for integration. They all oppose the civil rights movements too fast, go slow, don't do this. Civil rights movement was on its own, got out of hand, got away from moderates, just like the labor movement did. And in that tremendous pressure created through the brilliant use of strategic nonviolence, we got the Civil Rights Act of 64 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965. And what I'm trying to stress to you, they were forced. They were not something moderates wanted. They were something that was forced upon them. But here the deal between Southern and Northerners broke down in the opposite way. And that is, in the face of this rising strife, including what was happening in the cities, and the Northern moderates could see it coming, they never guessed how heavy it would be, but they saw it coming, and they voted with a liberal labor coalition to end the Southern veto, the filibuster, on the Civil Rights Act. That is, the Northerners now deserted the Southerners on a labor issue. Because in the South, you've got to understand, yes, it's racism, but it's also a class struggle. African Americans were brought here by these people to be the working class of the South. So I know a lot more than that's involved, but I'm making a power analysis. And the point is that the Northern Republicans deserted the Southern Democrats, and these acts were able to pass. The militancy generated the need to pass them, and the Northern Republicans then allowed them to pass. And in that context, black voters in the South could now force the worst racists out of the Democratic Party in Democratic Party primaries, and they quickly moved into Republicans. I give you Strom Thurmond, not so long ago, died at 100, who was one of the first, and he went and said, we've got to have a Southern strategy. Now we can do what we conservatives have always dreamed of, and that's have Southern whites in the same party with Northern conservative Republicans. Well, we all know that the Southern whites became Republicans over the issue of race. Nobody's really going to say it was over religion or anything like that, although they now talk religion and family and pointy-headed intellectuals and homosexuals and all of this kind of stuff. But it really was about this change in power relations. The Democratic Party could no longer fulfill its number one function for Southern rich, which was to keep African Americans powerless. No longer could do that. And in that context, you could really hate the federal government, because you must understand, to understand the Southern white mind, you must understand that the power relations of the South were twice militarily changed by the federal government in Washington, D.C. One of those was called the Civil War, and the other was troops did come to the Southern United States, first from Eisenhower in 58 in Little Rock, but later troops had to be federalized to change the South, and the white South never forgave. And it very quickly became Republicans. But it was not just the South, and I've already hinted that. It was Northern whites, including union members in Michigan, Ohio, Indiana, and so on. They thought their unions were secure, and they voted their prejudices. They voted their skin color. They also came to dislike feminists, environmentalists. They saw them as threats to their jobs, but they also, all of these people were also threats to their status as white males. They also then came not to like long hairs and anti-war protesters and all of these kind of things. And so we now talk about these Reagan Democrats, but I still think at the core is white racism. I think Larry Bobo, a great sociologist, is right, and what we have today is colorblind racism. It's at the core of all of these things. Now, something else was going on, though. And that is, if you were a white union member in Michigan, and a hell of a lot of them voted for a racist named George Wallace in 1968, and more would have if the unions hadn't really put on a pressure to vote for Humphrey, and I think take Michigan into the Democrat column in 68. But the point is, there's a huge potential in white middle America to vote its skin color. And that might have worked if their power-wise, if their unions had stayed stable. But something else was going on that we all missed, and certainly Mills would miss, and that war was that a new class war started in the 1960s. There wasn't a deal between the sophisticated conservatives and big labor. And what happened was, I said to you, liberal labor had just enough power to force some things in the Democratic Party. And one of the things they could do was to make sure the labor board did not screw labor. I'm really going to get fast now. We're running out of time. I might even get the Larry Reynolds level of blunt language here, but I won't use it really ever. But they did. The point is, the Democrats, liberal labor could keep the president, that part of the party, from appointing really anti-labor people. And John Kennedy, in fact, made a couple of liberal appointments to the labor board. And the labor board made a couple of decisions that really upset the corporate moderates and basically involved the question of outsourcing. And what the labor board says, hey, if you're going to take this out, this particular process out of General Motors and make it a separate company, that's outsourcing. That's where it started. Just move some factory to Indiana, make the headlights and other play, and then we de-unionize. We're going to have to bargain over that. Modern capitalists did not like that. They began a strong behind-the-scenes black-back war that basically involved you've got to elect Republican presidents in order to change that labor board. And that's what happened. And it happened, though, because the white middle Americans were now voting Republican. And as they voted Republican, as they voted in Nixon, whatever he did on welfare issues, which were for a while ameliorative, he in fact appointed a very conservative labor board. And a long and short of the story, but there's more to it than this one factor, but in the 70s and the 80s, the unions were decimated. They did not see it coming. And so people had voted their skin now had really voted themselves out of a union because their identities had become stronger with their whiteness than it had been with their union and their working class. That really brings us to today. We live in a situation where we have a corporate new right kind of a coalition which does appeal to instincts about male supremacy or heterosexism or all of the standard things. It does matter to those kinds of voters. And that coalition is then defeated the liberal labor coalition, at least. couple extra minutes in here. That's the sort of the heart of my power analysis of what really happened. But I want to say to you, I don't think a power analysis of the right term would be complete if we didn't look at the whole social structure. I said to you how important activists were for the labor movement, how important activists were for the changing situation of African Americans, people that we call the civil rights movement, which were great exemplar activists. I'm saying activists matter, but I'm saying the activists, I now want to say, made major mistakes. And one mistake was giving up on the Democratic Party in 1964. The left had always been a third party, but thanks to Southern African Americans, the left was actually drawn into the Democrat Party through the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party, an integrated party out of Mississippi that went to the Democrat Convention in 64 and got a compromise out of Johnson. But it wasn't a very good compromise, and everybody went home bitter, including a lot of the black activists. Well, they had a right to be bitter, but they never should have left that party. Structurally, they should have said, but Barry Goldwater said it in 60, and it just bites my tongue to say it, but when he didn't get the nomination for president, the right wing wanted to leave the party, and he gave a fantastic speech when he ended it. He said, "Grow up, conservatives, this is your party." And if somebody had stood up at that convention and said, "Grow up, Democrats, you left Democrats, you black Democrats, you liberal Democrats, grow up, this is your party." No, they left the party, and I give you Nader in 2000. Let's never forget that's a power analysis, and that's a mistake, even if some of us were part of that mistake. Third parties are futile waste of energy. They create big splits with liberals. The second mistake was the left switch to property destruction and violence. Talk of violence. Civil rights movement had given the new left a tremendous model, a model of strategic nonviolence, and it showed us what power structure research would say. You can't just be a liberal and write your congressperson or lobby, of course not. But you also can't throw bombs. You can't destroy what you bought. It won't work. It's crazy. Cesar Chavez used to say, summarizing a lot of moral and political arguments, he said, "Violence in America is wrong and it's stupid." And that's what we got into. And we still got it, diversity of tactics in the global justice movement. Where is the challenge to those activists that don't understand the importance of strategic nonviolence when one goes to disrupt the ongoing system? That's part of a power analysis. Activists who have made, I think, mistakes, easy to say in hindsight, I agree. Well, in closing, I think it's been a great 50 years of research for power structure research. It is summarized in these various books that David mentioned. But I want to say, power structure research, in my mind, has done better. But why hasn't it been even more impactful? Why aren't all of you have a whole course in power structure research, all of which disappeared in the 70s and the 80s? Why are you hearing about structural Marxists and historical institutionalism and state autonomy and so on and so forth? Well, I think, first of all, it reflects the wide rise and fall of these social movements. That is, it was social movements that made Hunter and Mills relevant. It was the civil rights movement. It was the 60s that carried people in. Secondly, I think as it fell, people went to other kinds of issues. Secondly, we had a lot of hope that just exposing the power structure, and people say, "Oh my God, there's a power structure. We've got to do something about it." Didn't work that way. It wasn't as useful as we thought, but I also think from my remarks just 2 minutes ago suggest, I think it was more useful about social change than many critics thought it was. But thirdly, it was not seen as theoretical enough. And by the post-60s, researchers and theorists were on to something different. Eric Wright has now said as much, but now people are writing their retrospects. Basically, the young radicals, the young sociologists, the young leftists, the late 60s and early 70s, forgot all about Mills and Hunter and didn't care about it. Structural Marxists were out to rebuild Marxism in toto as useful for large-scale social change. And here was Mills talking about Marxist theory as a labor metaphysics. He was talking about sophisticated Marxists, old futilitarians. You look in their books, there is no Mills tip on the sociological imagination. So the leading intellectuals of the 70s went elsewhere and left power structure research behind. And similarly with the state economy theorists who now call themselves historical institutions. If you look in their book, you will see that C. Wright Mill is never cited. It's very interesting to me on this point because Mill certainly thought the state was potentially autonomous. He just said it's not autonomous in the United States, which I think his research and subsequent research has shown to be right, and which historical institutionists then deny, which is why we then fight about the Social Security Act and the National Labor Relations Act. And so we're in a situation today where things stand. A Michigander rules. Her name is Theda Scotchbull. She's at Harvard. She trains the main students and your main teachers in a general way in the discipline are people that talk about institutions, historical institutionalism, structural Marxism, and so on. So they have won intellectually, even though I think we have won in terms of how the power structure operates and in terms of how, if you wanted to change America, you would have to look at power structure research. Can power structure research eventually dent this mainstream? That I don't know. But we're going to keep after them with new empirical studies. And that's why I've tried to convey a sense of excitement about it. And I hope some of you will defy the higher authorities as you march on to graduate school and become power structured researchers. Thank you very much.